second day of Dowiethon, and it's going pretty well. The weather outside is disgusting. It's like offensively grey and like an apocalyptic rain situation, which is awful. But I honestly don't plan on going outside today, so, you know, it makes no difference to me. Instead, I'm working from home. And working through my first Dowiethon book, which I started yesterday, The Mission House by Karis Davis. Chapter 17 in the book, which isn't that far, but I did have to actually put my ass in my chair in my office yesterday, which cut down on my reading time. I know, I'm also disgusted. The book itself, I think, is a bit of a slow burn. Like, dare I say, potentially bordering on boring. Like, I don't want to say that about my dear Karis Davis, because I fully enjoy Karis Davis as an author. I think her writing is banging. Also, her characters are amazing, you know, well-crafted, likable. This book, however, is a bit slow. It's a bit slow. Like, I was talking to somebody about it, or maybe chatting, or in a comment or something, where they said it was really, really slow up until the end, and then ended way too fast. Like, it suddenly sped up 1,000,000% and then ended, you know? So I'm hoping that's not my experience of the book, but it's looking more and more likely. Like, basically, just like, you know, synopsis. It's this British guy. He moves to India. We don't know why he's moved to India yet. He just has done. And we are sort of like getting his perspective on things. We're also getting the perspective of the padre, like the guy who's in charge of the mission house that he's like moved into while he's in India. Also another girl who lives at the mission house, we get her perspective, and also this like rickshaw driver guy, this like tuk-tuk guy, who follows this British guy around and insists on driving him everywhere. you know, which is fine and clever. You know, hopefully it'll speed up. So, like right now. Okay, last random thought, just last one for this disgusting Wednesday morning, quickly. The Fortune Men by Nadifa Muhammad has come up on my library app. Like my app for like audiobooks and ebooks from the library. And it's come up in an ebook, which isn't like really my jam, to be honest. Like I don't love an ebook. But I do really want to read this. I think it's going to be really good. And also it is Dowiethon related. So I'm going to try to fit it in. I'm looking at my Dowiethon book stack and it is extensive, so I don't know how I'm gonna fit it in, but I'm definitely gonna try to fit it in. It's based on this like real life thing that happened in Cardiff. I know it's not like, you know, factually related or whatever, but it's like a fictional story, like based loosely on this real thing that happened, where the Somali sailor was convicted of murdering a white woman just based on like bunk evidence, like fake shit and like no like real evidence at all. And I think he was actually like hanged in prison in the end. Like that was it, that was the end. Like there was no like happy ending. Like but I do really want to read it. I think it's gonna be really good. I think it's up for like loads of awards as well, even though it's brand new. So I'm gonna add that to my list. Okay, shit, sorry. Like I know I said that was gonna be my last thought, but I just have like another one just quickly. I also found On the Red Hill by Mike Parker on Scribd on audiobook. And I definitely want to add this one as well. I know this is too many, but I just desperately want to add it as well. It's early 2000s, this gay couple, they go to like witness this like civil partnership in this tiny like Welsh rural village of their like friends getting married, or civil partnership. And then those two guys die like within a couple weeks of each other, and they leave their home in this tiny rural Welsh area to those guys. And then this is like a memoir of those guys like going to live in that house. It says a mesmerizing entwining of queer love story, group biography, reflection on time and place, and celebration of rural Wales. On the Red Hill is so much more than the sum of its disparate engaging parts. It just sounds very peaceful and lovely, and like I love like rural Welsh settings. It's just delightful. So I'm gonna add that shit to my list, and like don't give me any judgment please, because I'm gonna try to get through these damn books. I just love them so much.
Faster than a speeding bullet.
Okay, so it's like World Book Day, right? But because my kid goes to like a Welsh medium school, like a school where Welsh language is like the language of instruction, they've asked them to come as their favorite book character in a Welsh book, like a book in Welsh. So that cut my things down quite significantly because we read a lot of English books in the house. But we did find Saren a spark, and now she's gone as this like superhero girl Saren. So we've got like the boots and like the belt and the little puffy hair and the like cape and everything. So that's her costume for today. Just gonna kick ass. We have recently discovered a potential issue with the costume, and that it's hard to pee because it's a onesie and has a belt and a cape. But I feel like it'll still be okay. Also, who doesn't want to wear a fucking fuzzy onesie to school, right? Like, I want to wear one to work. Can I do that? Okay. Okay. Quick lunch break update, right? The Mission House by Karis Davis is getting better. Like, it's still slow. It's still slow. Like, not a lot is actually happening, like, action-wise. But you're learning more about the characters and, like, getting their sort of backstories and, like, how they relate to each other. You find out the British guy has moved to India, like, as a sort of mental health break. Like, he had some sort of, like, breakdown at home in England, and he's sort of come here for some sort of break or whatever. And the girl who lives in the Mission House with the Padre was sort of semi-adopted by the Padre after she sort of grew out of the orphanage, sort of turned 18. And couldn't be kept in the orphanage anymore. So they sort of arranged for her to live in the Mission House with the Padre and sort of help him out and stuff. And she has like a couple physical disabilities, like birth things, like she's missing her thumbs and like one of her legs is longer than the other, whatever. And it's making it hard for the Padre to find her a husband. And he's like trying to, I don't know, negotiate a way for her to like, I don't know, get a husband. And the British guy, even though he's quite a lot older than this girl, has sort of like started teaching her English and like teaching her stuff and enjoys like being around her and stuff. And now he's like decided he's fallen in love with her and like wants to be her husband and stuff like that. And he's like pretending to be a Christian now so that he can like, I don't know, it's just really interesting. And like Priscilla, the girl, she was like stealing CDs from the market for ages, like country music CDs. And she was like talking country music with this random guy who wants to be a country music singer, and it turns out that guy is like the nephew of the Tuk Tuk Driver, blah blah. Like everything is like weirdly connected to each other. Anyway, I'm fully enjoying, like, the writing is still banging, you know, characters are fab. I'm happy with it. Next one also that I'm gonna start today, later today, is a buddy read with Betty. We're gonna read Dead Relatives by Lucy McKnight Hardy. I really liked another one that was written by this same author. Took place like, it was like a folk horror thing in Wales. I don't know if this one takes place in Wales, but the author is Welsh. Anyway, I think this one is short stories, right? I think this one's short stories, but maybe like quite long short stories, as in like two short stories in this book. Do you know what I mean? But we'll have to see. And they're like, I think also folk horror, so like lately, I don't know, I'll let you know. But I'm pretty excited about that. I haven't talked to her about how much we're gonna do today. Okay, I'm definitely running out of time now and have to go back to work now, but I had a random thought, like a side note that I forgot to say about the British guy in this book. He's like a librarian, and he was saying about his favourite books that he used to mess around with or like read or whatever in the library was these like dictionaries about old languages. There was like a Norn dictionary, and like he was saying about like the Norn language was the old language, like in sort of like 13th century, 14th century, like it lasted until I think like 1700s, in the Shetland Islands and the Orkney Islands, because they used to belong to Norway, you know? And like you're saying, like different words in the Norn language that he liked, you know, like glicket and stuff like that. And holy shit, the Wikipedia rabbit hole that I have fallen down to do with the Norn language, you would not believe. Just like go on Wikipedia, right? Put in Norn language and then just click on all of the blue things, like all of the different things, like the languages it came from and the countries it came from and what it turned into and all these different words and blah, blah, blah. Like you will end up somewhere completely crazy, and it's amazing. Last thought.
How was World Book Day? How'd your costume go down?
Good. Lots of people were dressed up as the same with me.
The same one as you, which seems crazy because it was sort of out of left field, that choice. It is weird that so many people chose it.
Five people.
Five people. Jesus. Did they all have onesies though?
No.
None of them had onesies.
I mean, someone, like Clara, Poppy.
They did? Yeah. Okay, well, you know, that's fair. Did they have capes, though?
Yes.
They also had capes?
Yeah.
Hmm.
They did.
Okay, well, you know, I thought, you know, we were going to go crazy and, like, do crazy stuff, but apparently they all had the same idea as us. Not all of them. What were other people?
Jack and the Beanstalk, Red Riding Hood, Alice and the Wonderland.
Well, these are not Welsh books, so that's good to know because we could have cheated and gone as Clifford. You know, I thought, you know, we were sticking to it. We were sticking to the rules, but, you know, if there's going to be cheating, we might as well go easier on ourselves and, like, be Matilda. How do you feel me?
Yeah.
Okay, there. Did it.
Thanks, Mama.
Okay, y'all. The Mission House is Dunzo's, Kaputsky's, end of the first book for Dowiethon. And I liked it. I did. I did enjoy it. I like Kara Stavis as an author. I really do. And her writing really speaks to me. I really like it. However, the other two I read by her, like, I loved them. Like, when I was done with them, I was like, whoa, that was good. And this one just, you know, it was good. Like, I wouldn't say it was my favorite. Do you know what I mean? Like, I think in the end, the idea that's supposed to, like, hit you most about the book is, like, this, like, relationship that this guy and, like, the Western people or whatever that were in the book were building with India and with the people in India. It wasn't based on a real India. Do you know what I mean? It was based on this, like, fantasy that they had in their minds of India, you know? And, like, the British guy, what he loved most about India was how it was the parts of it that were like 50s England. Do you know what I mean? Like, sort of like England and society in England was moving too quickly for him, and it was too modern, and he, you know, he didn't like it. So he sort of sought out this quieter, like, nostalgic fantasy view of, I don't know, like a Raj India or whatever. Like, and all of his relationships toward the people in India, they weren't, like, true loving relationships. They were, like, I don't know, like, looking down on them sort of relationships, you know, or, like, I have so much to teach you, like, that kind of relationship. And I think that's what, I don't know, we're supposed to take away from it. Like, it's this feeling of we're in love with, like a romanticized or, like, an idealized version of India. And that real India, like, isn't having it, you know. It's modern and completely different and, like, you know. Anyway, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed the characters. I enjoyed the writing. I enjoyed the feel of it. But in the end, I wasn't wild. I won't lie to you. Anyway, moving on. Okay, so I'm up late, right, reading this one. And it's giving me the skeebies. Like, the fact that it's, like, late at night and I'm the only one awake, like, it is creeping me out. I should have read it earlier today. I should have just done it. Like, it didn't seem like it was going to be that creepy, but something about nighttime and I don't know. Anyway, like, it's about this woman and her, like, creepy daughter and their creepy caretaker and their creepy cook live in this creepy house in the middle of nowhere, and they take in women who are pregnant. I think it's, like, the 60s. Like, they haven't said specifically when it is, but sort of getting 60s vibes. They take in women who are pregnant and they say, oh, we'll adopt your baby out, but they're not allowed to meet the parents that are going to adopt their babies. And now I'm getting vibes like that orphanage in Ireland where they found all those dead babies on the property. I feel like that's likely what happens to them. But, like, I'm not there yet. Maybe I've jumped to conclusions, but it's giving me proper creepies. Like, this kid, it's like 13-year-old daughter of, like, the mistress of the house, she talks to, like, the ghosts of her dead relatives, but I think they're just photos on the wall, because when she was, like, describing them to one of these women who's come here who's pregnant, you know, she's talking about them as well. Like, she can see them and they're in the corridor. I think they're photos, but the girl, I don't know, talks to them, and she's got this, like, super creepy dolly. I don't know what's up with the dolly yet. But I know as soon as they describe the dolly in more detail, like, that's going to be the time for me to go to bed. Like, to just wrap this whole thing up and watch a bit of, like, you know, Simpsons so that I don't have nightmares, and then just go to bed. Anyway, so far I'm enjoying it. It's very creepy, it's very mysterious. But tomorrow, for the pages we decide to read, I'm gonna read them in the daytime, in the morning. Okay, so this book so far is super disturbing, but creepy in a way I like. So I hope the rest is, like, I finished the first story. I hope the rest of the stories are just as creepy as that one. I quite like the ending of this one as well, so I hope the endings are good. However, I hope they're slightly less disturbing, you know, in like a mother dog eating its puppies sort of way. And also less predictable. Like, I did guess all of the things, like things that I'm pretty sure are supposed to like hit us and make us be like, shit. I'm pretty sure that I guessed them from the very beginning. And maybe I just read too much folk horror now, but I feel like that's not it. Like, I'm not that clever. Like, I think it just was poorly veiled and should have been, you know, less predictable. So I'm like half and half at the minute. Like, I like some things about it and some things I'm like, so we'll see. Okay. Welcome back from the pub. We left James at the Chinese to get us some chow mein. We're gonna go let the dogs out. I think it's time for me to admit to Betsy that I didn't get to my buddy reading Paige's assignment for today. I'm just gonna have to catch up tomorrow. It's just the reality. Okay, so Dead Relatives is not going as well as I had hoped it would do. Like, her other book, that author, Lucy Mahadi, her other one was about, like, witchcraft and, like, a sort of evil child, or, like, a sort of, like, a witchy sort of dude. And I quite liked that, and I thought that this one would also sort of be about that. And it's turning out, like, so the first story was, like, sort of creepy in this way, but sort of more just unsettling, do you know what I mean? And the rest of the stories after that aren't really creepy at all. They're just unsettling and, like, disturbing. And it's less about actual ghosts, like, as in dead relatives, and more about, like, people that are just sort of dead inside, or, like, people who the main characters wish were dead. It's, like, a lot of, like, pent-up resentment type stuff, like, where the women who are, like, wives and mothers don't really want to be wives and mothers and don't really like their husbands or their children, like, stuff like that. Like, it's not creepy, it's just a bit sad, you know, and, like, a bit, I don't know, like, I'm not liking it. It's not the sort of, like, creepy sort of folk horror thing that I was sort of hoping for. But I do have a third of it left. So I'm hoping, I don't know, maybe it'll change a bit. Like, some of the stories have been a bit, like, clever, you know. Most of them, to be honest, have been just super confusing. Like, the endings. I don't really get it. I don't know. We'll see. We're scoping out cake options at Costco for Amon and her best friend's, like, joint birthday party this week. I feel like the dinosaur one is good, but Spud's not into it. Also, while I'm here, I'm getting this shit. Okay, like, not naming any names or anything, but there may be a person who, instead of reading like she wanted to, just fucked around all night and then randomly decided to go out dancing. Like, I'm not gonna name and shame this person. I feel like, you know, there's a lot of shame to be had in the situation, you know? And, you know, if I was that person, which I'm not, I would probably feel, like, ashamed of myself, you know what I mean? But there's nothing to be done about it, you know? It's already been done. We'll just have to move forward. My options now. I have two of them. I can pick one. First one, go to yoga. Because I missed it last week because I accidentally slept through it because I was jet lagged. Or number two, just die.
just die here in bed, you know, which honestly is the better option, but so messy, like, for real, you know, so I was gonna clean that shit up. Well, I should probably just get up and go to yoga for fuck's sake. Okay, I'm up.
I'm not gonna lie to you. A dying in bed option is looking better and better.
Okay, so I thought that I sorted myself out, right? Like, I got up, washed my face, brushed my hair, jumped on my bike. I'm like, I'm fine. Let's do this shit. I'm completely sorted, right? I get to yoga, though, and Shan, she looks deep into my soul, right? Because she can see all my shame. She's looked to the very pit of me, and she knows. It's written all over my face. Like, Shan is a very kind soul, so I know that she hasn't judged me. But she's seen all my shame. She's like, did you go out last night? I'm fooling nobody. I'm fooling no one. Nobody. Don't have my shit together at all. Nobody. However, coming back on my bike, I remembered what day it is. Do you know what day it is? It is season 6 of Outlander premiere day. I'm gonna look online right now and see if it's there. Like, because it comes up on Amazon Prime, UK. Like, I never really know. Is it up there at midnight? Is it up at 8 a.m.? You know, is it? Do I have to wait for, like, it first to premiere in the U.S. before it premieres here? Like, blah, blah, blah. Like, I don't know if it's going to be up. If it's up, oh my god, I'm just going to fret all day waiting for the perfect time to watch it. I can't watch it now, okay? No, because, you know, mommy, I want a sandwich. You know, Heather, should we do the laundry? Like, just people messing with me all day, okay? I need to wait until they just, you know, leave me alone. Leave me alone. So I can watch it in glorious peace and quiet and just focus my whole energy and soul into watching Outlander season 6. I'm so excited. Oh my god, I just looked and it's there. Okay, I have finished Dead Relatives by Lucy McKnight Hardy, and the last third of it, so the first third of it was just one story, like the title story, Dead Relatives. The second third was a bunch of really small stories, like 1-2 pagers, you know, like not more than 10 pages or so. And then the last third was just three stories, like three sort of longer-ish sort of stories. And those three stories I fully enjoyed. I liked those more. And they were what, to be honest, what I had hoped, like, all the stories in the book would be, you know, based on what I knew of her as an author from her first one. So they were, like, creepy, you know, and, like, a bit, you know, unsettling, but not, like, disturbing and, like, gross or, like, I don't know. They were, like, creepy in a really good way, and I really enjoyed them. So that sort of redeemed it for me, like, a bit. So I probably wasn't going to rate it very high until those last three, and now it sort of bumped up for me. I appreciated that. Okay, anyway, that was done. Moving on now to Hello Friend, We Missed You by Richard Owen Roberts. This one, I don't really know a lot about it, to be totally honest. But it has quite a wide following, like an international following. So it's a Welsh author, takes place in Wales. But loads of people sort of outside of Wales have been, like, saying it's really good. It's got, like, a bit of a following. Hello Friend, We Missed You is a poignant and comic novel about loneliness, Netflix, existing, rural life, money, Jack Black, and learning to live in the least excruciating way possible. I think it might be a bit funny, you know? I don't know. I'll let you know. Anyway, I'm happy about this one. Moving on. Also, just as a side note, I went with my spud to the local store just around the corner. You know, they have these, like, World Book Day token things. So we found, like, a little coupon in one of her National Geographic magazines. It's like the £1, like, World Book Day tokens. We took it to the store and we picked out a World Book Day book for free. She just got to keep it for free. It's amazing. We got this one. Jemima the Pig and 127 Acorns. Look, it's, like, cute. It's got, like, little illustrations and cuteness. For free. So chuffed.
gosh. Outlander was so good. Now I have to wait another week for the next episode to come out. Like, what is this, 1998? This is disgusting behavior. Like, when I was a kid in the 90s, like, you know, you just took it for granted. Like, okay, new episodes come out every week on this day, blah, blah. But, you know, this Netflix life, it spoiled me. Like, all of The Crown, like, the whole season of The Crown comes out all at once, doesn't it? You could just binge that shit. Like, what are they thinking? Once a week. Anyway, book stuff. Book update. Hello, Friend, We Missed You by Richard Owen Roberts is going so well. I'm really into it. I'm really enjoying it. I'm like that far into it. This guy, basically, he lives in London or something, and he's like a film guy. Like, Jack Black has out a 2-year option on something that he's like written, or some sort of screenplay or something like that. But his dad, so he's from Anglesey, this island off Wales, this Welsh island. It's like quite a small community. He's from there, and his dad is in poor health. Like, I think he's like got dementia, or like he's ailing in some way. I don't know. I'm only this far in. But he's come back to Anglesey to like look after him a bit or something like that. And this kid, he's encountered his carer, this woman who sort of like looks after him in sort of an unofficial capacity. She's more like his friend, you know. But she's quite a bit younger than him. She's the same age as like the kid, roughly. And she sort of stays the night sometimes if he needs help with stuff, blah, blah, blah. So this guy who's gone back, he's like just 100% made up of pure awkwardness, like in relation to this woman. Like, he's got 8,000 like super awkward interactions with her, and I'm loving it. Like, it's so funny, like in a quite like subtle way, you know, or like sort of borderline cringy, but I'm enjoying it. It's really funny. I really like the writing as well. You get sort of caught up. And also, I like how it's sort of laid out. It's laid out, like, sort of poetically. Like, I mean, it's not a poem, it's prose. But it's laid out sort of uniquely. I quite like that. And it's going really fast. Like, I read all this bit just in a really short time. I'm really enjoying it anyway. Okay, I'm going to kill this vlog here and this shit now. If you have any questions for me, anything, any comments whatsoever, please let me know. I think I'll pick up a new vlog from here. So next week we'll have another reading vlog, I think, depending on like how tired of it I am at the end of this day. But I think next week we'll have an update for how this one goes. Like, I think it's gonna go really well, but we'll see. Anyway, thank you for watching. Any questions, any comments at all, please let me know. I will see you next week. Bye bye bye.